Now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic radio theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
Well, here it is, the final show of the Stan Freberg Show. Now, this episode was the last show of the series. It was originally broadcast October 20th, 1957.
This is the 15th show of the series of the Conked Out Radio Series.
From Hollywood, we present the Stan Freberg Show.
With the music of Billy May.
Plus the songs of Peggy Taylor, Doss Butler, June Parade, Peter Leeds, and Dutch Conlon, Rhythm Ayers.
You may well find us on your TV, because in case you did not know, we're bidding fond farewell to, fond farewell to, fond farewell to R.A.D.
Good evening. Well, welcome to the 15th and last in this series of Sunday evening radio shows. In answer to your many requests, and by the way, we are really deeply grateful, all of us, for the enormous response, we're going to recreate for you tonight some of the things you told us that you enjoyed the most. Well, I'm certainly going to miss our little Sunday evening romp together. The thing that made it fun was never knowing quite what was going to happen, you know. I'm going to miss talking to those real-life, believable people, for example, who used to come knocking at our portals. Ah, a guest bids entrance.
Mr. Freeberg?
Yes?
I'd like to discuss a problem with you. Yes, indeed, a problem with you!
Well, if you just come down off the wall, we'll talk about it.
I'm having trouble with my car. I can't get through on Sunset Boulevard.
Well, what seems to be the trouble?
The road is being blocked by sheep. Yes, indeed, being blocked by sheep.
Well, that must be... I mean, that must be Monsieur Toulet and his tuned sheep.
I don't care what they are. I've got to get to work. Yes, indeed, back to work.
What kind of work do you do?
Brain surgery!
If I ever need any brain surgery, why, I'll be sure and get in touch with that gentleman there.
Pardon me, Mr. Freeberg. My name is Tweedley.
Well, we all have our problems.
I am the censor from the Citizens Radio Committee, and I must okay all the material used on your program here. So I'll just sit back here and interrupt whenever I feel it necessary.
You mean you plan to stop me every time I do something that you think is wrong?
Exactly. I'll just sound my little horn like this.
That's a darling little horn there.
And then you stop, and I'll tell you what's wrong.
Somehow I can tell it's going to be one of those days.
You just go right ahead, Mr. Freeberg. Don't mind me.
Yeah. And now I would like to sing...
You forgot to say thank you, Mr. Freeberg.
Thank you, Mr. Freeberg. Mr. Tweedy.
You're welcome, I am sure.
Yes. I'd like to sing an old river song in honor this week of National Treat to Beat Your Feet on a Mississippi Mud Week. Mr. May, if you please.
That was very polite, Mr. Freeberg.
Old Man River, that
old... All right, Tweedley, politeness I dig, but what in the world is wrong with Old Man River?
Well, the word old has a connotation some of the more elderly people find distasteful. I would suggest you make the substitution, please.
I suppose you insist?
Precisely. You may continue.
All right, music.
You forgot
to
say thanks.
Got to say thank you, yes. Thank you, thank you.
Elderly man river, that elderly man river, he must know something, but he don't say nothing.
Grammar, grammar.
Yes, all right, Billy, music. Yes, thank you, thank you.
You're welcome, I'm sure.
Elderly man river, that elderly man river, he must know something, but he doesn't say anything. He just keeps rolling, rolling. He just keeps rolling along. He doesn't plant taters, potatoes. He doesn't plant cotton, cotting. And them, these, those that plants them are soon forgotting. But elderly man river, just keep rolling along.
Excellent.
Thank you. Oh, yeah, sorry about that. Well, we got by that one. You get a little. Okay, take your finger off the button, Mr. Tweedley. We know when we're licked. Well, that concludes Elderly Man River. Oh, yes, and thank you for being with us, Mr. Tweedley.
You're welcome, I'm sure.
October 20th, 1957, The Stan Freberg Show on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
You know, a lot of times you have to choose between something high quality or something that saves you money. But if you can get both, why not? Especially when it comes to healthcare. And that's MediShare. You get both. The typical family saves $500 a month switching to MediShare. And that's huge, but it's also true that people are way more satisfied after making the switch, too. The customer satisfaction rate for MediShare is double that of the typical health insurance plan. Double. It's because MediShare works. It's been around for more than a quarter century, and members have shared more than $3 billion of each other's bills. People love having telehealth and a huge PPO network, so yeah, really, you could save a ton and like it better. Imagine being happy with how you're taking care of your health care. If you're self-employed or part of the gig economy, or you just want a plan you're happy with, you can call right now and get a price within 2 minutes. Here is the number you need. Call 833-34-BIBLE. That's 833-34-BIBLE. 833-34-BIBLE.
Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, more of The Stan Freberg Show, October 20th, 1957.
Well, you seem to enjoy our version recently of that typical soundtrack that has come galloping out of your TV sets this fall. So here then is our Western hero, Bang Gunley. That is just the soundtrack. No peeking at the picture now.
Eating Corporation of America presents Bang Gunley, U.S. Marshal Field.
Morning.
Howdy.
You Bang Gunley?
That's right.
Well, let's ride on out and look over the spread.
Okay.
Good.
All right, well, then.
Somebody sure cut through that fence, all right.
Yep. Somebody sure cut through that fence, all right.
Back to our action-packed story in just a moment, folks. But first, a word from the newest member of the Eating Corporation of America's breakfast family, Puffed Grass.
Puffed grass, eat puffed grass. Chock full of vitamins and chlorophyll, too. What's good for Bossy?
Mm.
It's good for me and you. Puffed grass!
Hi, boys and girls. This is Jet Crash. I'm a test pilot. Believe you me, I couldn't break through the sound barrier every morning. If I didn't start off my day with a stomach. Full of puffed grass. $100 million cows can't be wrong. The only breakfast food containing chlorophyll, too. Yes, when us test pilots are all alone up there, pulling out of a sonic dive on the verge of blacking out, with a pull of 9 G's on our body, I can't tell you what a comfort it is to have that extra chlorophyll protection. Two. It well makes me the most popular test pilot of the annual Lockheed prom. Yes, you can spot the puffed grass eaters in any crowd. They got a green mouth.
There goes a boy with a green mouth. He's a puffed grass eater. Puffed grass.
Tune in next week for another action-packed adventure of Bang Gunley.
Bang Gunley, U.S. Marshal Field, riding east, west, north, and south. You can tell he stands for justice by the way he draws a gun and the proud look about his green mouth.
That's just ridiculous. Well, what comes now is a capital record of mine that you requested most. As a matter of fact, we received a scroll through the mail with a whole list of name on it. requesting that we do this number. So if Peter, that's too piercing, Leeds, is standing by, I'd like to sing for you the Banana Boat song.
Daylight come and me one go home. Day.
Wow, man. Easy day. I'd ask you not to shout like that.
Well,
it's like right in my ear, man.
Well, goes with the song.
Yeah, yeah, but don't holler in my ear, man.
Well, that's authentic calypso.
Yeah, but like, why shout next to me, man?
Well, shout go with the bongo drums.
Well, not my bongo drums, man. I mean, move away, like.
Well, I don't see why.
No, man. Stand over next to the guitar, man.
He sent me over here.
Yeah. Well, then, sing soft, man. I mean, like, wow.
Okay.
It's too loud, man. That's better.
Easy day, easy day, easy day, easy day, easy day, oh. Daylight come and me one go home.
Yeah, man.
Cox.
Oh, work all night and a drink of rum.
Daylight come and me won't go home.
Stock banana till the morning come.
Daylight come and me won't go home.
Left 6 foot, 7 foot,
hold it, man. Hold it,
punch.
Oh, it's too loud, man. It's too loud.
Left 6 foot.
No, hold it. Oh, my ears. Right, my ears. No, hold it, man. It's too shrill. It's too piercing, man.
I don't see why you... I don't see why I can't...
No, man, it's too piercing. Like I don't dig loud noises.
Well, you ruined the whole...
Piercing.
...record is what you...
Man, be tough. I'll take my bongos and go, man, because the whole thing is like bugging me anyhow.
Yeah, wait a minute. I won't shout.
No, I'm cut, man, like I didn't want to make this gig in the first place.
No. Wait a minute. I be soft.
Yeah. Well, then, back off me, man. It's too piercing.
Okay. How's this? Dale!
Too loud, man.
Okay.
It's too loud, man. I can still hear you. Would you mind leaving the room?
Okay.
Crazy.
Daylight come and me won't go home. Daylight come and me won't go home.
Hey, beautiful bunch of ripe bananas.
Daylight come and me won't go home.
Hide the deadly black tarantula.
No, daylight, man, don't sing about spiders.
I see you, man.
I mean, ooh, like I don't dig spiders.
Well, I mean, that's how the song goes. He goes, hide the deadly black tarantula.
Daylight come and me won't go home.
Is that it? Can I go now?
No, not yet. We got big finish.
Yeah, man.
I locked myself out.
Crazy.
I come through the window.
Daylight come and me won't go.
Stanley, boy.
Yeah, Billy, what is it?
I got like a little gift for you myself, like.
Well, man, like, what is it?
Well, aquarium playing bandleader, like I found floating in Balboa Bay.
Floating in Balboa Bay?
He was clinging to a hunk of the Aragon ballroom.
Yes. As I see him wringing out his accordion there. Well, how does it feel to be back on dry land, sir?
A waterfall, a waterfall! Mr. Freberg, I understand your program is going off the air.
Why, yes, it is.
Ha, ha, ha.
All right. Look, you don't have to make fun of me.
Oh, look who is it talking.
Yes, well, there's that. Now, look, just to show you there's no hard feelings, how about playing us a short instrumental medley based on the names of girls?
I just happen to have that arrangement with me. A one and a two and a...
No. No, that's not it. Thank you very much. We enjoyed that.
Now for my next number, I would like...
No, I'm sorry.
...to play...
That's all we have time for. Thanks very much.
Please, somebody turn off the Freberg machine.
All right. Look, just have a seat, will you please, sir? Now, who could that be? Coming.
Well, we'll see who's at the door in a moment. October 20th, 1957, the Stan Freberg Show here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. The conclusion follows these important messages from your favorite station. Thanks for tuning in to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Now the conclusion of the Stan Freberg Show, the final episode, October 20th, 1957. Who's at the door?
Yes?
Hey, package, Mr. Stan Freberg. Will you sign here, please?
All righty. Gee, that's an awfully big package. Gee, it must be about 10 feet tall.
Oh, you tell me, sir. It come all the way from the Himalayan mountains.
The Himalayan what?
A mountains.
Well, let's unwrap it here. Give me a hand.
Yeah, okay, sir.
All right. Big one, there. Right, here we go. That's got it.
Hello there, Stan.
Well. Well, it's my old friend, the Abominable Snowman. Yeah, I guess that messenger had never seen a 10-foot monster creature, a gentleman like yourself, all covered with hair before. He got pretty scared.
Yeah. Well, chalk one up for me, Stan. I mean, that's all in a day's work for me, you know.
Yeah, that's right. Terrorizing people is your business, isn't it?
Yes, terrorizing the various mountain climbers. That is my trade, and I am proud of it. By the way, is it hard on you doing both voices like this?
Yes, that's a little hard on my voice, yes.
It's a little hard on mine, too.
Well, I hope it's not too bad.
Not too bad, no.
You sure?
Sure.
Positive?
Positive.
All right.
All right.
Okay.
Okay.
Say, there is something a little different about you there. I know what it is. You're not wearing orange sneakers like you usually do.
Yeah. I'm glad you noticed, Stan. I'm wearing the purple. That's the ensemble I picked out for my trip.
That's not much of an ensemble, is it? I mean, just the sneakers.
Well, it's an ensemble to me.
Yes. Well, how did you get all the way here from Tibet?
Gladys mailed me.
What brings you here?
Well, it burned me up.
Yes. Well, what is it that the...
Well, we heard you were going off, so we were stunned. Oh, just stunned. So I came stateside right away to do something about it.
Well, really,
No. Now, come on now. Who do I scare?
No, nobody. It's no one's fault.
Listen, we've enjoyed your program. We don't want you to go off. Who do I frighten for you?
Well, there's no need to scare the wits out of people about this.
I was thinking more of scaring the wits back into them.
Well, it's the thought that counts, and don't think that I don't appreciate it.
I could scare a couple of sponsors for you.
I'm afraid we've already done that.
One would gather, yes.
Well, Stan, baby, what are you going to do now? Oh, I don't know.
Well, I'll tell you what you're going to do, buddy, buddy. You're going to come back and live with Gladys and me in the high Himalayas.
No, really. What would I do there?
Well, I could teach you to be an abominable snowman.
but I'm only 6 feet tall.
Well, you could scare midgets.
No, I don't really... I'll
lend you my orange sneakers, Stanley.
Yeah, but size 23, yeah. Well, I guess I could stuff a little snow in the toes.
Yes, that, or I could stretch your feet for you.
No, thanks. No, here, give me your footsie. I'll show you there. No, please, I'll take you at your word.
Okay,
all right. Well, I guess it's settled, then. I'll be an abominable snowman.
Oh, Stan, you made me so proud.
And so concludes our final program.
Wonderful, wonderful. Now off with the show.
All right, will you be quiet just a moment, please? Well, gee, the time has just slipped by. I'm sorry we didn't have time for the tune Cheap tonight, for example, but maybe it's just as well. We had a little jurisdictional union dispute between the American Federation of Musicians and the 4-H Club. Well, I guess that just about winds up the egg-rolling contest for tonight. And I can't think of any better way to say goodbye than surrounded by all my good friends at home and in the studio. It's been a delightful 15 weeks. And on behalf of my producer, Pete Barnum, my technicians and my cast, all of my cast, allow me to thank our entire audience, particularly the gentlemen of the press, for their most encouraging comments. So now, until we meet again, this is Stan Freberg saying thanks for listening, God bless you, and good night.
Stan Freberg Show was produced in Hollywood by Pete Barnum and was written by Stan Freberg and Pete Barnum. Featuring the music of Billy May, Judd Conlon's Rhythm Airs, and the songs of Peggy Taylor, George Butler, Peter Leeds, and June Perez. Bud Sewell speaking.
And as CBS sinks slowly in the west, we say farewell to the Stan Freberg Show. The last episode, October 20th, 1957, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, here's an episode of the soap opera Claudia. This was originally broadcast on October 20th, 1948.
And now, Claudia.
David, where are you? David?
I'm in here.
Washing the baby. He looks all beautiful and shiny. Clean clothes, clean everything.
What's the occasion?
Dr. Barry's coming to see him. I want Bobby to make a good impression.
You mean you ought to make a good impression?
Hey, what are you doing at the desk?
I knew my peace and quiet was at an end the minute I heard your chirping voice.
What are you doing?
Working.
What are all those blanks and sheets of paper, David?
I'm filling out my insurance reports on the accident. Now, are you satisfied?
No. How many do you have to fill out? This looks like scads of them.
Scads of them.
Don't you think I ought to do it for you, darling?
Why?
Well, I know lots more about the accident than you do. You were unconscious most of the time, remember?
It might interest you to know that I wasn't unconscious until after the accident.
That's good. Okay, it might have been worse.
Very funny. Go away.
What sort of things do they want to know?
Everything.
Well, for instance?
For instance, everything. Use your head. What time, where, how it happened, why it happened, whose fault it was, what happened to the car, how much it cost to repair the car.
A fortune, that's how much it cost.
Exactly, the kind of specific answer they're looking for. A fortune.
Still, I have as much right to fill out this blank as you have.
What makes you think so?
Well, you're my husband, it's our car.
All right. If you want to fill out these forms, all right, you go ahead, it's all yours.
No, thank you. I just wanted to know what they want to know, that's all.
Well, go ahead.
They better pay you all they owe you, or else.
Well, you write them a letter.
I'll wait and see. David, you be persistent. You have to be firm with these insurance companies.
What have you been reading?
Nothing. I heard something on the radio.
Oh.
What are you looking for now?
I'm running out of matches for my pipe.
Oh, wait a minute. Here, catch.
Thanks.
Welcome. You know that the first thing you said to me when you became conscious after the accident, you said, you know what? I broke my pipe. You're such a fool, darling.
Well, it was my best pipe.
And you were my best husband.
Were?
Are. Poor Jesse.
What?
Poor Jesse.
I give up.
What, darling?
One minute you're talking love to me, and the next you're saying, poor Jesse. Who is this Jesse, and what you have to do with us?
Everything. Darling, don't you remember? Jesse Mason, it was her husband who crashed into your car.
George Mason. Poor devil.
He didn't have much of a reputation around town, did he?
I guess not.
What happens to people to get them like that, anyway?
Lots of things, I suppose.
When George Mason was a little boy, that he was just like any other little boy. Sweet, hopeful. Like our Bobby, maybe. Then he grew up and he became the town good-for-nothing. I wonder if ever when he was, shuffling along Main Street late at night, eating a shave, I wonder if he ever thought back to when he was a little boy, all clean and new, and then looked at himself and wondered what happened to him.
Darling, I'm afraid that's life.
And it's frightening. David, you haven't heard anything about what's happened to Jesse, have you?
No, maybe Dr. Barry will know. He knows most all the news around town.
Gosh, I feel so sorry for her. When you were lying unconscious in Dr. Barry's office, she and I were waiting together in the waiting room. We were both waiting to hear about our husbands. Did I ever tell you how she arrived at Dr. Barry's office with a man?
Uh-uh.
He just couldn't get her to be quiet. She howled and she cried and she said if anything happened to her husband, she'd sell her place and move out of town and start all over again. She didn't have any children. Gosh, I pitied her so.
Well, pity is a very strong word.
I know. She was so busy pretending she knew what she'd lost, and she didn't have the least idea. Her husband dying was just another man. And yet she knew she ought to feel something, so she screamed and she cried and howled. Poor Jesse.
Darling, it's not very nice to feel sorry for people.
I know, but I can't help it. I just wish there was something I could do for her. I'm sure she must need some help. In a way, I feel as if I owe life something now that you're well and everything's perfect again. I even feel smug.
Well, you ought to be ashamed.
Well, I'm not. Now, stop talking. Get back to your insurance, Blank.
Me? Stop talking?
Yes, you. Get back to work.
Hardly been able to get a word in edgewise.
Stop complaining. Fill your pipe and start to work on your forms. And don't talk to me. I'm going to read.
Some women have more nerve.
Shh. I'm concentrating.
Yeah, that's a novelty.
Oh, good. I'm reprieved. Here's Dr. Barry.
He won't run away. You don't have to break your neck running to him.
I never break my neck. Hello, hello, Dr. Barry.
Well, Claudia, how's everything?
Well, David's well, the baby's well, all's well with the world. My gosh, don't I sound smug, though.
I don't know why you need a doctor to call on you.
It's a luxury. We just love having a visit with you.
Well, it's a pleasure to come.
Well, hello there, doctor. Come on in the living room.
Well, David, you're looking like yourself. I was just telling Claudia, I don't think you need a doctor at all.
Well, we always need a friend. Come on in.
Yeah, it's a fine house you have here. I always like that paneling over the fireplace, especially now that you've scraped it down to pine.
Yeah, through 11 coats of paint.
And one of wallpaper.
Now I wouldn't part with it for $1 million.
Don't you wave a check under his nose, Dr. Barry. It won't do any good.
I wouldn't even offer. No man should be parted from his paneling. Well, now, I must remember that I'm a doctor, not an architect. How's the baby?
Bobby's fine. He doesn't cry. He sleeps all the time. He eats wonderfully. He's getting enormous.
I can still pick him up with only one hand.
Well, I don't think you'd like him very much if you couldn't, David.
We'll go up and see him in a little while, Dr. Barry. I haven't weighed him. I thought I'd wait till you came.
And then she won't be able to cheat.
I wouldn't.
Now tell me, David, seriously, how are you? Have any headaches?
No, not a one.
Good. No difficulties at all?
No.
Are you feeling any fatigue, eye strain, nervousness?
A bit, no.
Open your left eye wide.
No, I've been feeling all right. Nothing at all. I'm better than new.
Fine. Now, what about your collarbone? Can you raise your arm yet without any pain or discomfort?
Well, I'm still a bit shy of moving it too suddenly, but it doesn't seem to trouble me much when I do.
Pain in your chest?
No, not a thing.
Well, then, I dare say we've come out of something that could have been very serious with remarkably few scars.
I'm very grateful, Dr. Barry.
Hey, you should be.
David says I'm even smug.
And you said it yourself.
Dr. Barry.
Yes?
I don't want to be nosy, but is there anything we can do for Jessie Mason?
Do for her?
Well, I mean, I can't help feeling terribly guilty that everything turned out so perfectly for us, and heaven only knows what's happened to her.
No, that's very nice of you, Claudia.
No, it isn't nice. It's almost an obligation.
Well, I don't think you're obligated to Jessie in any way.
Her husband is dead. Mine isn't. I know that lots of people criticize Jessie for the way she carried on and the fake her life was, but I only feel sorry for her.
It's not as bad as being critical, but Jessie's all right.
Doctor, we were just wondering if you might happen to know what happened to the woman.
She said she was going to leave town. Do you know if she did?
Well, as a matter of fact, no, she didn't.
Well, is she going to?
I doubt it.
Oh? Funny, I thought surely she would.
Well, things have changed a little for Jessie in the last few weeks since George died as a result of his own negligence. She's not quite the woman she used to be.
How awful. You mean she's not taking it well?
Oh, no, no. Quite the contrary. It's as if Jessie were finally awake, shocked into waking up. Yeah, she's become quite another person.
Well, that sounds like good news, Doctor.
Yes, it is. She's taken a job at Mrs. Allenworth as a companion. Hmm. You know, Mrs. Allenworth is blind. She's dependent on Jessie for every step she takes. That's quite a responsibility.
Yes, I should imagine. Quite a responsibility.
Seems to me it's just what Jessie needed. It's interesting, isn't it? How lives twist and turn, and if you give them plenty of time and all the rope they need, eventually they find their own way home.
It's so painful for some people.
Yes. Still, that's their own destiny. Things work in a larger pattern. You have to believe that the small make up the large. Days fit into months, and years into centuries. Every soul in this town of Eastbrook is part of the life of this community. Oh, I've seen lives come and go. Fortunes rise and fall. Folks squander themselves, and then, at the last moment, save themselves. So I never rush to make a judgment. Just wait and see.
Well, that's quite a philosophy you have achieved.
Well, when you've seen as much life as I have, David, such a philosophy comes easy. You can't be critical of one person when you know that that one person is not alone, but a part of the general order of things. Sooner or later, that's proved to you.
Just as with Jessie. There was an accident, her husband was killed, and now she's a person again. And a month ago, nobody would have believed it.
Except Dr. Barry.
Yes.
Now, David, don't give me credit for it. It's just a matter of survival. If you live long enough, you learn to take your time with people. And most of them come out all right. I know. I've seen it. Yes, it's the larger pattern of life that you must look for.
And I am a little bit embarrassed.
Embarrassed? Why?
Well, I didn't wait. Here I was feeling sorry for Jessie, almost condescending. Oh, pity. Yes, I wanted to help her, but in a way I was a little proud that I was me and not Jessie Mason. So, now I'm a little bit embarrassed.
No reason to be.
Just when I think I've learned all about life, how tragic, how exciting and beautiful it can be, I find I'm just a beginner.
We all are beginners.
Do you sometimes get the impression that everything you buy costs a lot more than it used to? Then think a minute. How much did you pay for that last case of Coca-Cola? $1, just like always. You see, some of the good things of life haven't gone up at all. How's your supply of Coke? Better put it on tomorrow's marketing list.
Well, I've just seen the young squire, Mr. King.
You mean the heir to the Naughton Acres?
Young Bobby. He's a fine baby boy.
Yes, Master Bobby's a great favorite of all of us. We're staking all our bets that he'll grow up to be a fine man, too.
He should. He has the family for it. A finer young couple I've never met than Mr. and Mrs. Naughton.
I feel just the same way, Dr. Barry.
Now, maybe what I like best about them is they're self-sufficient. Most of their pleasures come from themselves.
Yes, they don't often go around looking for entertainment, like tomorrow night. Even a simple game of solitaire is enough for an evening's fun with them.
Well, that's the way life should be. Goodbye, Mr. King.
Bye, Dr. Barry. Every day, Monday through Friday, Claudia comes to you transcribed with the best wishes of your friendly neighbor who bottles Coca-Cola. So listen again tomorrow at the same time. And now this is Joe King saying au revoir.
October 20th, 1948, Claudia here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Thank you for making us a part of your day. Would you thank this station? Support their advertisers. It's their kindness and courtesy that allow us to be with you each and every time we roll around here on your favorite station. And if you miss a day, you don't have to miss a single show. All of our shows are available on demand by going to classicradio.stream. That's classicradio.stream. You can stream our shows on demand, learn more about Classic Radio Collecting. You can contact me there. You can find our social media links and a links list of places where you can download our shows by podcast. And you can even buy me a coffee if you like. That Buy Me a Coffee money helps us acquire additional Classic Radio Theater programs. So that's at classicradio.stream. Classicradio.stream. Thanks for tuning in. Tell your friends. Great radio shows are right here at this spot on the dial. Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox on your favorite station.